Good morning. So, I'm Dmitry Lazarenko from Gelastic, and during this session I will talk how containers can help Java developers to improve DevOps processes. And a few words about Gelastic, about what we are doing. In Gelastic, we develop platform as a service solution for Java. Originally, our name was made as Java Elastic. And now we support .NET, Python, Node.js, many other technologies. And during last 4 years, we have tried to form the ecosystem of platform as a service powered by Gelastic across the world. And now Gelastic is available in more than 40 data centers worldwide, in more than 25 countries, and over 200,000 of developers, including Java. About half of them are Java developers, use Gelastic to develop and deploy the applications in production. And we have won Duke Choice Award, this Java Oscar, in 2011. And another relationship with Java is that father of Java, James Gosling, 1 year ago has joined our team as independent board director, and he helps us to make our product better and improve our own processes and vision. And we know that he loves sushi, so he's a good guy. So let's move to the main topic of this discussion about DevOps processes, about the problems. So usually you have you develop different applications, sometimes on different programming languages, and usually your applications are not simple. And if they are not simple, there is a challenge on how to deliver them to different environments, like to deliver your application from your laptop to dev environment, shared dev environment, or to QA environment, or even to production. And so it's a challenge if you have multiple application service, multiple front-end service, databases, API service, and etc. And the same challenge was in cargo transportation before 1960. If you have a lot of goods and if you have a lot of different transportation methods, it was a challenge how to deliver all the goods in a similar way. And people, and it was really, really issue how to ship all different goods using different methods. But people invented some unique, unique technology. It's simple, but unique intermodal shipping container, and they changed the world of shipping your goods. So these containers have help it to package all the goods in the unified containers, and the key is that all the goods can be operated, can be transported using different transportation method in the same way, and they can also be combined and delivered in multiple instances in a safe way. So. Container approach have changed the world and saved money and time and the economics significantly. And the same technology appeared in developers world 2 years ago. So Docker container technology have created a shipping container system for code. The idea is that you can place all the components like database servers or API servers or whatever into standard and unified containers, and you can deliver all the containers all this, to the different environments. Like you can even develop on your laptop your application, put in the container, and transfer to the staging server, or even you can transfer from staging to production if you want. And Docker technology have changed the world, so it seems that it becomes the standard technology for shipping, building, and then running code. And it seems to be a silver bullet. It maybe a silver bullet, but it's not easy. Usually, it's not easy to manage all the containers, to transfer them, and a lot of issues, and it's not trivial in many times. So, yeah. And that's why, so it's a good technology, but you need to properly operate, you need to properly manage it to deliver your software in safe mode. And to be confident is that your production will not fall in any cases. So let's talk about technical details. What is the main difference between container technology and hypervisors that are used rapidly in enterprises right now? So in hypervisors, you have hardware host, you have a hypervisor, and multiple virtual machines. And each virtual machine runs its own kernel and runs its own operation system that doesn't depend on any other operating system. And there is an overhead in terms of RAM and CPU utilization, and also in terms of launching of each operation system instance. Unlike hypervisors, containers provide another approach. So in hypervisor, everything is emulated, it's been emulated, like hardware, all the hardware has been emulated. In containers, all the containers, all the application containers use the shared system kernel, and they use the same system resources from hardware host. So they share the RAM, the CPU, and others and others. And the key feature of containers is that they are really flexible and they are lightweight, and they can be spin up in a second, unlike the hypervisor VMs that need at least several minutes to be spin up. And due to this elasticity and due to use of shared resources, running container doesn't consume extra resources. So it means that it consumes the same operation system kernel, and that's why the density of the containers is at least twice or three times better than density of virtual machines. And the key is that Docker didn't invent container technology. So they said that the first container technology, but actually containers appeared long ago in Unix V7. And after that, in FreeBSD, jails, they were improved. And also they appeared in Linux vServer, and etc. And you know that Solaris Zones was a production ready container for Solaris, and now a company called Joint uses improved Solaris Zones to create their own Docker implementation. And in 2005 appeared Open Virtuosa container, which are used by service providers, mostly by service providers right now. And in 2008, Linux containers were also created, and so we call this technology just LXC. It's a standard container approach that is used by default Docker implementation. And in 2030, Docker technology appeared on the market, and it shaked it, and provides new view. And also, Rocket containers appeared 1 year ago. So containers have a long story, and they're still developing. So about 3 days ago, community announced that they working on a joint common container format. And nowadays, we have three big players on this market. We have standard Dockers, which are trying to push their technology. We have CoreOS that are more secure and allow and provide several useful services as etcd. And we have Virtuosa containers, or OpenVZ, that are used by service providers for more than last 10 years, and they provide good security and isolation. And as I said before, container is just technology, and you need to proper orchestrate it, you need to proper operate it, and that's why a lot of container orchestrators appeared in the market, like Tutum or AWS Container Service or Kubernetes by Google or something by IBM. So a lot of container orchestrators, they are almost different. They provide some unique features, but there is no standard approach to orchestrate the containers, and that is the challenge. And in Gelastic, we also we included in this race. So we are creating our smart container orchestration that uses OpenVZ containers, that we secure OpenVZ containers to manage everything. And we use containers from 2011, before Docker was appeared. And even we use containers for Windows. So actually, there is also container technology for Windows that is that was created in 2008. So the main challenge when you use containers, so you can use them safely for development of your applications, but if you want to move them to production, so you need to be confident in the safety of these containers, and you need to be confident in safety of your environment. And the first issue of standard container approach is a lot of security issues. So there are lack of proper isolation in terms of CPU power or RAM power. So for example, you can just in LXC that is used by Docker, you can just assign the priority of your process, but you can define the appropriate limit maybe in megahertz or in part of CPU. And the same for RAM, so you can, if you are inside a container, you can attack entire virtualization host and kill entire hardware machine because there is no proper RAM limitation. The same for network, so you can't limit inbound or outbound traffic properly. And one of the key issues is that you can use only data, you can use only volumes that are in particular in this hardware host. So standard Docker containers are not secure yet, and that's why most of providers used to run containers inside virtual machines. But it's not good solution because it's strange because of security issues. They have to run inside virtual machines. But there are some solutions on the market, container solutions that provide advanced security, like containers by Joint, which are based on Open Solaris, and containers by OpenVZ that were improved during last 10 years. And they provide proper isolation in terms of networking, CPU, RAM, and et cetera. And the key point is that can run on bare metal without any security issues, without any risks of attack on hypervisor. The next challenge is high availability. So if you deploy your application in production, if you deploy multiple instances, you need to be confident that your application will not fall in case of VM failure, in case of container failure, or in case of even hardware machine failure. And usually people use approach like pets versus cattle. So in terms of this approach, pets, you have a small portion of pets, you set the nickname for them, and you worry when each pet is ill. And you try to keep him alive. In terms of cattle, you have a lot of cattles. You just assign the UEs for these cattles, and you replace each cattle when it dies or becomes ill. So this approach is used by OpenStack. It's used by Kubernetes orchestrator for Docker. But the issue is that suitable only for stateless application. So if you have stateful application, if your application stores some sensitive data inside each container, or if you have legacy applications that need to be ported to container, you can't use this approach. So you need to find something else, or you need to recreate your application from scratch. In Gelastic, we prefer approach that is called pets and cattle, not versus cattle. So we offer, we created several solutions for have availability, like on application layer, like automatic replication of sessions between your Tomcat or Glasswish instances, or sticky load balancing that is provided by HTTP load balancing. And the most interesting is that we also implemented support for high availability on hardware layer. So we have implemented software-defined storage with deep integration with virtualization that allows high availability, and such unique features as live migration and smart distribution of your containers to achieve high availability and the best access to hardware resources. So it looks like if you talk about software-defined storage, this allows you to handle failure of entire hardware machine, and Gelastic will automatically recreate all the containers that are running with same data as was on failure machine on working machines. Or you can even handle failure of entire data center, and if you have two or more data centers, all the data can be automatically restored on your disaster recovery data centers. So that's a good solution. Another issue is predictable maintenance. So the challenge is that usually in production, you need to keep it live all the time, and you need to avoid any downtimes, even when you upgrade the application or when you apply some security patches for Linux kernel, or you just update operating system. So it can be done using standard continuous approach that is provided by Docker, but it can be done using live migration. So in this case, you can migrate all the containers live to the another hardware machine to perform some maintenance, and this is done without reboot, without any interruption of end user service. And this feature is available in OpenVZ virtualization technology using, it's based on checkpoint and restore in user space, and allows you to transfer both file system data and RAM snapshots, and also CPU registry snapshots from one hardware machine to another hardware machine in live mode without any interruption. And so that's a really cool feature, and it will soon available in main Linux kernel. Another challenge is how to place, how to provide high availability during the initial placement of your containers, and how to provide the better access for physical resources like CPU. So some applications, like maybe Hadoop applications, require access to a lot of physical CPUs to fast handle your data. And we use, like, our orchestrator uses anti-affinity to place different components of the same environment to different hardware machines to achieve this high availability. And next challenge is high density. So as we saw before, containers provide at least two or three times better density compared to hypervisors, and that's good because you can save your money on the hosting, cloud hosting. But container services that provided by major providers are unfair because they used to run containers inside hypervisor VMs, and this is unfair because you pay for the reserved limits, like you pay for the whole VM on AWS, even if you don't consume these resources, even if you consume only 1 megabyte of RAM. So that is unfair, and that's why you can, if you have proper virtualization, like OpenVZ or Solaris, containers in Solaris, you can run containers on bare metal without any security issues and with automatic vertical scaling. So the automatic vertical scaling means that your application, like even GVM, can be scaled up and down within defined by your limits without restart of your GVM processes. And in terms of GVM, it looks like your heap is being scaled up and down depending on the load, depending on the traffic. So we have implemented this solution in our product. So we learned how to tune GVM to get back heap RAM back to the operation system if it's not needed anymore. So and it leverages flexibility of containers and allows you to pay only for the use resources and to use only not to pay for the some reserved resources. So that's a unique feature that's only available by Elastic. Another key feature is that provided by some containers implementations is deduplication of RAM. So virtualization allows you to determine the same blocks and inside RAM pages and use only one instance of the same RAM page. It uses copy and write compatibilities. And the next feature that is used in production for your application, if you have applications that need to be scaled automatically depending on the traffic, depending on some conditions, you can use it by you can do that using, for example, Kubernetes. So you can configure after scaling for your application, for your application's servers, for load balancers, and even for databases in some cases. But there is a challenge if your application is not stateless. If you have a stateful application, like you have Tomcat, multiple Tomcats that should be scaled and that should be should handle some local data inside each container. So you need to somehow reconfigure Tomcats during scale out or scale in. You can also you need also to register Redis connection or any other connection. Like if you have Hazelcast replication, you need to reconfigure your Tomcat nodes to use properly this scale out cluster. And that's why we use the same approach, our orchestrator uses the same approach as Amazon Lambda. So it's event-driven event-driven orchestrator, so you can subscribe on different events that is happening in cloud controller, like if you scale up your application or if you change the limits of vertical scaling, or you start, restop, you can subscribe on these events and execute any actions and write this scripting on different languages. And so this can be used for tweaking of applications, application configurations. That can be used if you create clone of your application and you need to reconfigure connections and et cetera. So, and the scripting is based on GSR 223. So moving next, if you talk about DevOps processes, there is a war between developers and DevOps, because DevOps like to develop applications, and when they try to configure deployment of application in production, they trying to configure databases, firewalls, it's bad for them. It's bad for relationship with their wives and etc. And it's bad for whole life, and people stuck in this work. And usually it's a challenge to for Java developers or for any other developers to deploy application in production or staging. We have operations engineer, and the problem of operations engineer is that developers say everything works on my development environment. It's your problem that it doesn't work on production or staging, and that's why people created a methodology of development, so proper application development using lean methodology, like it's called DevOps, and it's responsible for the automation, integration, automatic test, collaboration, etc. So it helps to speed up time to market for your applications. It helps to improve relationship between your dev and ops team. Usually DevOps cover different scenarios, so they cover initial configurations of the environment, they cover maybe zero downtime, redeploy of application to the production, they cover automatic scaling of application, monitoring, etc. So a lot of tasks that are handled both by developers and DevOps. Oh, sorry. And we try to simplify their life, and we provide, unlike console access, command line access, we provide user interface and self-service portals where DevOps can create complex environments with clustering of application servers or databases. So it's really simple stuff, and we have some short video how a girl of 5 years trying to create applications with Nginx, with Tomcat and MongoDB, and she just clicks on this UI and creates everything in four clicks. So, and in Jelastic, we provide for DevOps ability to use different languages, and we provide certified containers for Java and for other languages, including .NET, which is a challenge. And you can, in terms of Docker deployment, you can also use this UI approach and create each Docker image using UI, and not to use command line, because it provides a lot of human errors. So that helps DevOpses. Another task another approach that is helping to improve DevOps processes is microservices. So microservices concept have appeared about 1 or 2 years ago. Unlike standard approach of pre-SO applications and unlike SO applications which use loose coupling, microservices approach allows to split your team on different split your team between different small tasks, and you can you can offer for each team to develop a service that can be interconnected via API with another service. And using this approach of small pieces, you can organize faster delivery processes. You can deploy your each component of your application faster, and you can redeploy of your complex applications even without downtime. So that's a good approach. And so the key the key points is that it provides easy testing, easy application lifecycle management, and faster continuous delivery process. And so usually in terms of microservices, you used to split your complex application, complex monolithic applications into different services. So, for example, you can split services on different application servers. You can also split database. And you can create multiple environments, and each environment is responsible for particular service. And each environment can be scaled independently and can be updated independently. Like you can update environment 2 without downtime, and you can do this with database, and etc. And in Elastic, containers help to develop microservices applications. So due to this lightweight nature, you can split your applications into small pieces, into small containers, and each container is responsible for particular functionality. And this is an example of one of our customers that have split his application into multiple containers. So it's music encyclopedia application, and he used very trendy technology like Neo4j for graph for handling graph data. He also used Solr for searching, and so when he split his application into microservices, he improved continuous integration, and he improved time that he spends for the update of his production environment. So that's a good story that is properly covered by microservices. Another story is continuous delivery. So containers are lightweight, and they provide ability to spin up complex environments, the same environments for dev, for staging, for production. And containers also help you to spin up even continuous integration infrastructure. Like you can create using Dockers, you can create Jenkins server and multiple Jenkins nodes that are responsible for build and deploy of your application. And using this microservice approach, so you can improve testing of your update patches for your applications. Like usually you have in case of Docker, you usually use approach that you may use Docker Hub Registry and deploy your application to development environment, to staging environment, and etc. And after that, if each test passes, you can deploy it to production. But sometimes you need to test how your update patch works for production application, and you don't want to affect production data. You don't want to affect production users, and so that's why we provide a feature that is called cloning of complex environment, and that allows you to clone entire production environment and to move its data to developer environment. And after that, you can test how your update patch works for this production data, and you don't affect anyhow your production environment. That's really cool stuff that is provided by a live migration feature of OpenVZ, and it significantly improves DevOps processes and improves decreases error rate. So let's move, scroll down. Yes, and some promo. As I said before, father of Java is our good friend, is our independent director. And during Java 1 in San Francisco, we will organize dinner with James Gosling. And you can be at this dinner. You just need to create your environment of Gelastic and share how Gelastic helps you to develop or deploy your application. And in this conference, we also our partner LunaCloud also offers a 50-year voucher for your cloud hosting. You can find these vouchers inside your bags, so and you can use Gelastic for free for 14 days, and after that you can also use 50-year voucher to host your production or university application, etc., on Gelastic. Thank you so much for listening. And do you have any questions?
Hello. My question is, you talk about that you can copy all data from production environments to development environments. Does this framework permit the anonymization of data when copying from production to development, or it's a hard copy of the production environment?
So by default, it's a hard copy. So if you talk about some changing of data, it can be done. So we have, let me show, we have approach that is called cloud scripting. It's very similar to AWS Lambda. Let me show this page. And it allows you to subscribe on events like the clone of environment and perform changing of data in database to avoid any lack of personal data and etc. That can be done, and you can also perform some backup of logs or some. You can do anything.
Okay. Thank you.
Well, if there are no more questions, please, a big round of applause for him. Thank you so much. One last comment. We always have the feedback box there, so if you want to cast your vote, please do. We'll be honored to have your feedback, and we'll pass the feedback to the speaker. Thank you.